watching NotesIn9.
Hello, and welcome to NotesIn9. I'm David Leedy. Episode 76, What Are Java Beans? On the other side of fear lies freedom. Okay, this is taken from my MWLug presentation, and I didn't actually intend to do this part yet. I intended to do this later on, but there's a couple NotesIn9 shows queued up that are going to talk about Java Beans, so I thought, well, maybe I should bump this one up and try to clear the air and get some information out there on what it is and what it's not. So that session that I did was that NotesIn9 Live XPages edition, etc. So the slides look a little different because I'm too lazy to redo them into my normal format. So, okay, before we go on any further, there's a classic XPages statement that probably everybody has heard by now, and it's this. You do not need to know Java to build XPages apps. And that is absolutely true. 100% that is true. You don't need to know Java. You probably already do know some Java if you're building XPages apps, but you don't really need to know it and get into the syntax and the code. Now, there's another thing that I think is true is that since about R5, maybe 4.6, I forget because I kind of ignored it, IBM has been trying to get us notes and download developers to use Java. You know, they've given us Java agents. You know, the writing's kind of been on the wall. They made pushes to get us in a web sphere and whatever other stuff that they were pushing or so. But it's has seemed for years and years, it's Java, 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 Java. And we've said, yeah, no thanks. We're not going to do it. And we fought against it. We said, we've got our formulas. We've got our Lotus script. We're good. Make that better. And we're happy. And we fought against IBM. IBM won. So it's time to learn Java. You don't need to know Java to make an XPage apps, but you probably want to. In the long run, it's gonna behoove you to at least get a better understanding of some Java concepts. Now, that doesn't mean you need to know beans, though you probably want to. But you're already using Java objects in XPages. And we'll talk about that, I'm sure, a couple times. So what I want to do is I want to revise that original classic statement of you don't need to know Java to write an XPages app. And what I'd like to say is we're not going to be afraid of Java anymore because it's not worth getting afraid of. And how do I know you shouldn't be afraid of it? Because a wise Java sage once said this, that if I can learn Java, anyone can. And that was Jeremy Hodge, and he's an excellent download developer and Java programmer, and he's given me some guidance, a lot of guidance in learning Java, which I'm not saying I know yet, but at least I understand it enough to start talking about it. So before we get into what is a Java bean, I want to just talk briefly about our coding toolbox. So we've got a bunch of different things we can use for XPages. We have these simple actions. We have at formulas that have been rewritten in the server-side JavaScript. We have the JavaScript syntax itself, which is usually referred to as server-side JavaScript. We have Java objects inside there that we can use inside that server-side JavaScript. And then there's pure Java code, which can take the form of managed beans, and I don't think this is an actual term, but this is what I call it, unmanaged beans. So before the end of this show, we're going to spend a fair amount of time talking about the Java code. But before we get there, I just wanted to talk to you about a couple of these other things. So, for instance, they've given us these at formulas, right? We've seen them at DB column and at DB lookup. And they're familiar to us because we had them forever in client-side development and Domino, classic Domino web development. But just because we have them doesn't mean they're good. Doesn't mean they're bad, but doesn't mean they're the end-all be-all. Like, for example, a DB column and DB lookup. Does it return an array or a string? Well, it depends. You know, if there's a value or if there's multiple values and stuff like, or if there's no value. Does it have a, you know, it still has a 64K limitation. You know, last I looked, it was, you know, I think it's the 21st century, 2012, and we've got a tool that is very commonly used that has a 64K limitation, and that does suck. And I've said it in public, and I'm just saying it here. That's lame. So we have them and they work for us and they're comfortable, but that doesn't mean that they're what we really should be using for every little thing and building apps around them like we did in R3 when we didn't even have Lotus Script. So I like to say that these rewritten at formulas are like the sugar the kids take with medicine. You know, it helps get that medicine down, but it's not really good for you. Gosh, I wish sugar was good for you. So here's just a little example, and I had a live demo at Pittsburgh, but it wasn't that great, so I'm not going to do it here. But let's just look at this view here. So here's a multiple categories column view. We got first column state, second column city, with multiple categories in both. And I wanted to do a look up into a combo box, kind of like pulling, getting into that second column. And it didn't work, for the DB lookup. What it would return for me is would just return, one city. So if this is Alaska, it would only return one city if I just try to do a straight DB lookup. Now, okay, I should probably make another view that's flat and stuff like that, but I'm also trying not to make extra views in these databases. So I kind of thought it would work, but it didn't. So what I had to do is I had to avoid DB lookup to populate that combo box, and I had to use some server-side JavaScript code. But let's look at this server-side JavaScript code for a second. It's not all JavaScript, right? So we've got a database, var DB. Okay, that's a database object model. But the object model for XPages comes from the Java side of the world rather than Lotus side of the world, Lotus Script side of the world. We're going to talk about that in a little bit. So we get our hold of our database like we normally do. We get a view. We get a view navigator, and we're walking the view navigator. Now look at this view scope. Okay, so I'm passing in the state. So that's basically the first combo box. A state combo box is bound to view scope, VS state. And then this city combo, this drop-down box, that is what this code is for, is using that, pulling that state from this view scope. Well, what's view scope? It's a map. And a map is a Java object. So already we're three lines in. We're using Java, whether we want to or not. View scope, session scope, application scope, request scope, Java objects. Okay, so back to the entry. Now we make an entry, a notes view entry. We use our navigator. Now we're making an array, var my list equals new array. Now the new array, now that's just more pure of a JavaScript concept. But again, as I said earlier, that the domino object model or the Java object models to begin with. So as we walk through all these cities and we add them to an array, if you see this line that says entry.recycle, why is that needed? Because you have to recycle Java objects, unfortunately. It's not something you have to do in Lotus Script, but here in server-side JavaScript, we have to be aware of that. What happens if you don't recycle it? Your server will eventually crash, probably. Try having a demo on xpagescheatsheet.com that spits out 50,000 records and having people use it. It causes your server to crash for weeks and weeks on end until Sidar takes pity on you and helps you out and tells you why it's crashing, that you didn't recycle your objects. So we have to be aware of Java more than we've ever had to before. It's just a fact of life now. But that's good. It gives us a lot of power. Now let's look at this code here. This is an example from the wiki from Deanna, and it's just a simple code on a view control where you can put the check boxes in, and what you can do is you can say get for the view panel, you can get the selected IDs, and then you can walk through those IDs and then get a hold of whichever documents you've selected, right? So we also have a simple action for that for delete documents, but what if you want to do things more than just delete the documents. So this is just a little JavaScript array. No Java really is at play here, other than the objects, the object model, on walking through and getting the documents that you've selected from a view control. But if you don't want to use a view control, what do? If say you want to use a repeat control, there's no get selected IDs for a repeat control. Well, and I've done this a little better, a little more in depth in a previous show, but I wanted to cover it here briefly, is you can create a Java object and put it into your scope. So actually you're putting a Java object inside a Java object. So I have code var my list equals new Java util ArrayList. And then I can put that my list, which is an array list, into session scope, and now it's available. So now in my example, which I'll show you in a second here, is I can have a button on each repeat, and then the collection name for the repeat row is row data. So that button can basically say row data, get the document and get the universal ID, and then put that into this variable called key code. And then I'm going to get the array from session scope, and then the Java object has some nice methods for contains and add, and then I can basically say if my array does not contain key code, add this universal ID to the array. So now I have that array. So let's take a look at that and see if I can find that. Oops. So I believe it's this demo. So here's the first one, right, which we looked at. This is just simple. I'm going to count this up. And this is just a simple view panel using that get selected IDs business. This demo here is now I'm using Java objects. And I can refresh it. Now, I just didn't do a count. I'm just showing the units, but obviously I can get a count here. And that's how that works. So let's just look at that in Designer briefly. So demo 3A is just what you would expect. Let's go to source here. Basically what I had on that slide. Demo 3B is at the top of this page. And I'm going to make this a little bigger. And the post open view is where I'm creating this Java util array list, and I'm putting that in session scope. Then for my buttons here, for add, and let's look at remove since I wasn't even on the slide, is to remove this, which has a rendered property on it. Let's see this rendered property. So basically wherever I want, I can just get this session scope, this array, from pull it down from session scope, and then I can work on it. Okay, you see that? So remove would be, you know, get the universal ID in a variable, you know, and then basically remove that from that array list. So there's no save on that array list, it's just done. That's just the Java object. And then this is basically the code from the slide. I get the universal ID for the row, put in the key code, and then I pull down that array again, and then I add it to the array. An array list is, you know, kind of like a list, similar, a map too, in LotusScript. Actually, array list isn't like a list in LotusScript. The map is like a list in LotusScript because it's key value based. An array list is just an array, pretty much. But the list is what gives us these other methods, and you can find these out. And now I'm rambling on that. But anyway, so that is a Java object that we're using. We're using maps, we're using array lists to really make things nice and easy, and to give us, you know, nice control over what we want to do. And we can update that. Oops. So that's a bad way to update it. And then let's remove that. Okay, so moving on. Okay, Java beans. Okay, so we're gonna go slow on this, but this isn't a big deal, especially if you're a LotusScript coder. There's very little difference than LotusScript. Java beans is an object. That's all it is. It's like a LotusScript custom class. And I think it's John Jardine is, I'm talking to him about trying to do a show on LotusScript to show us custom classes in LotusScript. But I couldn't wait for that because we got these Java shows lined up. So it's just an object that you make yourself that does whatever it is you want to do. I like doing these business objects, like a person or a company or a shipping manifest or whatever. Then I put my methods in there, and it speeds up your coding, and it really does improve your quality. Once you start making your own objects, once the methods are there and they're tested and they work, you can just reuse them. So now your pages have less code in it. You know, if you're using LotusScript and LotusScript agents, your agents are a lot cleaner because you're just calling methods and properties, not unlike you do with a domino object model. It's just that you control it yourself. A bean is just a Java object, and it can be managed or what I call unmanaged. I think sometimes instead of unmanaged, they use the term plain old Java object or POJO, but I'm not 100% sure on that. But I like to call it unmanaged, and we'll get into that in a little bit. So I'm going to show you this person class, and I made a state class as well. And the person class has get first name, get last name, as you would expect. And then I created is girl, is boy. I can load it from a document. I can load it from a unit. I can pass a unit or even another key value in there if I wanted to. The state class is a little different in that it can hold people objects. And it has its own methods of like get people count and get boy count, stuff like that. So let's just look at some of these on the web before we look at the code. Whoops. That's embarrassing. Okay. So if we look at this demo. Okay. This is, I haven't looked at the code in a little bit since Pittsburgh, but I'm pretty sure this is generated from Java. And if I'm wrong, I'll correct myself. But this could be an export to an Excel spreadsheet. But I'm just showing it on the web here. And then let's look at this demo. And then this is one where I can pick a state and it's going to calculate how many people there are, how many girls, how many boys, and this is an unmanaged Java object. Okay. Oops, let's go back. I should have made this a little better. And then finally, demo 4B, I can pick a state here. Now this is a managed bean that's doing this. And it's going through the list of this 50,000 database that I have to find out, you know, what's what. So this is basically the same thing as the other one, except there's a managed and unmanaged version of it. So let's look at some of this code. Okay, now this was not meant to be a how to get started with Java Beans. It's more of a what Java Beans are. So we're gonna go lightly over some things, not a lot. Okay, so if we look at demo 4, what this is, demo 4, and we'll go back here. This is an X agent, right? Okay, so if you've seen some of the other shows, or hopefully you're familiar with the concept of XAgent, XAgent is an unrendered page. And somewhere in here, for this XPage, is rendering has been turned off. Yeah, here it is. Rendering is false. Okay? So what that means is you can go into it and you can get a hold of the response and send back whatever you want to a browser. And this is how you can do a fairly simple export to Excel agent. So all this code is basically the typical from an export to Excel example, which I have on xpagescheatsheet.com. So this area just starts setting up the databases, because I do a lot with external databases and linking and stuff like that. And then I have the ability to pass in a certain state or whatever and stuff like that. But here's where it starts to get interesting. Here's my first bit of Java-ish code, is I declare a person variable. And this person is in this package, com.notesin9.examples.person. This is the class, the object. Okay? And this is kind of cool. If you're ever testing export to Excel, rem out your application VNDMSXL bit and just replace it with text.xml. So then it's just easier to test with. And then when you're done, then just put this back, and now you've got an Excel file. Okay, and it's just writing a table. And then when I come down to loop through my records, I'm loading a person object from Java. So this is basically the heart of it. And that person object, so I load it, and then that person object has methods, get first name, get last name, and this is what I write back out to the browser inside this table. And then I just print it, basically. Or that the writing prints it. This is probably for debugging. I forget. Okay, so and then I've got to recycle it because you do have to be careful with Java and loops. So how do we get this get an object with get first name and get last name, something that we can load a document? I'm passing a document inside here. Okay, well if we go to our Package Explorer, go to our database. Now there's a couple ways to kind of like do this. Now I did this manually rather than using the Java object or the Java design element because it's a little wonky in 8.5.3, but it's supposed to be better in 8.5.4, I'm told. So if we come in here this way through Package Explorer, and let's expand this. This is not going to be rocket science, and this is not going to look that unlike a Lotus script custom class. So the name of the package is com.notes9 examples. I'm importing a couple things here. The serializable thing, and serializable is kind of like the missing fourth episode. Jeremy did three getting started with Java episodes for Notes9, Intro to Java, which were great, but he kind of saw something shiny and had to get paid, so work got in the way, and he didn't get to the fourth episode, which probably would have talked about this serializable. You want everything to be serializable. How do you make it serializable? All you have to do is basically say implement serializable, and we'll see more talk more about that as we talk about building these things. I'm importing some of these packages. This is one of the reasons why you want to use Java. Probably not here because I'm not using them, so this might be a bad example. But Java has thousands of packages on how to help you format dates, on how to do arrays and maps, and all sorts of stuff that I haven't even discovered yet. Encoding URLs, all sorts of things have been done for you, and then you can import them and make them available. Okay, so this means that I haven't used this thing, so you have a good editor in here as well. So what's the first thing we do in this object? Well, I declare some variables, private strings and doubles. Okay, this is the same as saying dim first name as string, you know, for the most part. It's just a little different syntax. Okay, and then a bean needs to have an argumentless constructor. Actually, a managed bean needs to, and since I do run this managed, you just need to basically have something that says that doesn't take any arguments, so XPages itself can create it and manage it on their own. So here's where the first key thing is, this load. Remember, because I passed that document in to this object. And what does the load do? Well, this doesn't really look that hard. It sets first name to doc get item value string first name, last name doc get item value string last name, etc. Get item value double. That's just like server-side JavaScript, really. There's nothing too fancy about that. And then I've got these return methods. Get first name returns first name. Get last name, get number. Okay, the only thing that's kind of funky here is the is girl and is boy is Booleans, and you use is rather than get, just by standard. And if gender, which is set up here, gender from the field. So if it's male, then I'm going to return true for is boy. If it's female, I'm going to return false. That's all it is. That's not a lot of code. And quite honestly, this was written for me. You know, so if I were to delete this right now and click here and say, where is it? Source, generate getters and setters. And I can say select getters and say okay. There it is. So I even have to write that bit. That came basically from what we're doing up here. I wish we had that in Lotus script custom objects. So I'm not going to save that because I don't trust myself. And that's all it is. So I've created a Java object that can hold my business logic. And then for that web page, return the first name, the last name, and whatever else I want. And it's a nice world to live in when you separate your business logic. It's not hiding behind buttons. You know, it's just like Lotus script when you started using Lotus script custom functions. You know, then if you made the next level to objects, it's just a progression. So rather than having a server-side JavaScript script library to do this, which I could have easily had done, I'm starting to build this bigger object that's going to be more reusable, There's even ways to get this object to span databases. Try that in Lotus Script. So this person could be made, is similar to like you can have your own personal extension library. This person object can be made available to 8, 9, 10, every database available on the server. So if you're like me and a corporate developer, that's kind of good stuff. Okay, so anyway, getting back to the other examples, let's look at 4A. Now, 4A is this unmanaged Java object. So the first thing I did here was before the page load, I created a variable called state, which was this state object, which I haven't seen yet, but I'll show you that in a minute. And I put that in the view scope, very similar to the example of that repeat control where I used that list array business. Okay, so now this object is available for the life of my page. Okay, and then in here, on the on change event of this drop down, is I'm loading the state object with whatever I chose. Okay, and then back here is where I just start pulling values out based on methods. So every time, since this is unmanaged, every time I want to use this object, I just pull it down from view scope and I call the method. Get state name. Total people, get people count. Total girls, get girl count. Total boys, get boy count. Okay, so let's look at that state object. And it's in the same package. Okay, now it's the top's going to look very similar with you know, I've added things that I needed and stuff like that. And it implements serializable. This is like a little, just a unique key for serializable because you're supposed to increment it or so if you make changes to live applications or some crap like that. I don't know. But 1L is usually fine. So then I make maps. What's a map? It's like session scope, request scope, application scope. And the other one, view scope. So private map, people list. So I set up these maps. Then I set up, the name of my state as a string and the count. So I try to keep a count. So when I load it, the first thing I do is I clear the object if I'm reusing it. And then I call this method populate people. So what do we do in populate people? I instantiate my maps. Again, this is just syntax. This is, it's a little weird to begin with, but it's not scary. But basically up here is I what are you doing? This is the equivalent of like dim person as string or whatever. And then this is saying like dim session as new notes session. Okay, so this is basically just activating them now. Okay, and then I'm getting the notes context. This is a different way to get it, so other Java guys use something different, so I was just playing around with that. And then I, get my database, get my view, get my navigator from category, and I get the first view entry. And this really screwed me up for a little bit. How dumb is this? Okay, this says get first document when it really returns an entry. So that's not a Java thing. I think that's the same way in dealing with navigators and Lotus Script as well. I just don't like it. Okay, so then I start looping. So what do I do here is I create a person. I use that person object. And then I load that person object with the current document. So now I've got two objects going. I've got the state object I'm in, and this is my first person object. And then what I do is I put that person object in basically the all people list. This is probably getting annoying with my moving the mouse. So after I put everything in the people list, then I take that object and I say, is it a girl? If it's a girl, I put it in the girl map, or like it's like an array, or a Lotus Script list. Or if it's not, I put it in the boy map or array or slash list. Okay. Now, that did not make three, this is the beauty of it, that did not make three copies of that object. That object is only in memory once, that person, and then there's pointers in these maps to that object in memory. So you can add this object over and over again to different maps and not just eat up all your memory. That's beauty right there. That's awesome. So now I can do stuff like this. And then I just keep looping, and again, you gotta be careful of recycling. And then I have just a total people count. And then there's just some debugging stuff here for me that goes to the console with this system out print line. Which here's a shortcut if you're ever doing this. Syso and then control space gives you that. So the editor is nice. There's tons of little tricks like that in there. And then the rest is return this map, you know. And all these are generated automatically again through that source business. That's all this object does. And we're not going to update that. Okay, and this is the unmanaged bean. Okay, so, okay, well, that's unmanaged. Well, what's this scary managed one? Oh, well. If you look at the managed bean one, and we look at the events, well, this is run down, or marked out. So that's not there. This guy here, well, let's look at the on change first. Events on change. State low. Well, where'd state come from? I'm loading it. I'm calling it, but where does state come from? Let's see. This guy here, return state, get state name. Let's get people count. Okay. Well, hey, here's the trick. Okay, and all this is managed means that the application will control these things for you. So they're just there when you need them. Okay, that I like the sound of the application doing things for me. So if we come back to our Package Explorer and go into, I think it's Web Content, WebInth, Faces Config. The only difference between those pages is these lines here. So I've created this managed bean, so it's available. This actually would have been available on the first page, the unmanaged one. I just chose not to use it. So the exact same objects are being used, the exact same way, where the methods are so, but for this demo 4B, it's being created automatically because I have this code in place here. Basically, the managed bean name, I call it state, so I could call this anything I wanted. What is it? It's com.notes9.examples.state, and it lives in the view scope. And that's the only difference. So that allows me to just say, okay, this bean is going to be here, and I can just trust that it's going to be here. Okay, that's not important to show you, but this is. So then I can just load it without first grabbing it from scope all the time. And that's just nice to do that. Now, another thing you can kind of do here, which I'm not going to just do this live, but you'll see in other shows, is there are advantages to this. So this is JavaScript. I'm returning state.peopleCount. You know, I believe I could pretty much say the same thing. I could say state. I don't need a get. State dot people count. And well, let's try that. Let's just see if that works. If not, I'm going to be kind of embarrassed. And I've got to refresh this. And I did not try this ahead of time, so we'll see if this even works or if I have to edit. Yeah, and I screwed that up. Why did I screw that up? Because it's custom. This should be expression language. See, if this was a paid podcast, that it would probably be better. Let's see if that works. Let's refresh that. Well, let's just do it that way. Okay, and the people count is there. So what was that all about? Why did I do that? Well, this is expression language, and I haven't quite figured it all out yet. But what it means is with your beans, you don't have to do the get and set. Okay, that's done for you. It knows that. So now I haven't shown you any setters yet, but if this was like an editable field and you use just state dot, you know, people count, if that was editable, then it's just a convenience. So if it's you're editing it, it will XPages will use set people count. If you're reading it, it will just use get people count. So this is how you do that with expression language. And that was a little more roundabout explanation of beans that I wanted to go into. I thought it was going to be short and tight, and I think I rambled a little bit, but that is what beans are in XPages. So I hope you found that interesting and informative. Please post any questions on the blog post at notesin9.com. Stack Overflow is another great place for questions. Here's my contact information. We're going to have a lot more bean stuff coming up. Again, which doesn't mean you have to use beans in your XPage applications, but you don't want to be afraid to use them because there's all this rewritten code or pre-written code. There's packages like iText and Apache Poi. There's just Java is everywhere. And if you're not aware that you're already using it, and if you're afraid to go further into it, you're going to do yourself a disservice. And hopefully we'll see that in future episodes. So thank you very much for your time.